Haverim, haverim. What an opportunity it is for me to join you at this time. Waiting for the Shekinah to descend. Here we are together, saluting you from the mountains of Pennsylvania. Hallelujah! Shiveinu, Hashem Alecha, Venu Shuva. Haverim, haverim. Here I am, haverim, just reaching out to you at this time, and I decided to come out and speak to you. I got some pokes and some questions from you, and I'm just checking the volume to make sure that you're hearing me. Let's see. I'm recording. And there's the volume testing, 1, 2, 3. So I know you can hear me. And so, here we go. Okay. Here we go. I decided to come on the internet and be with you a little while. I had some complaints from some of you that I don't come on too often, so I had one or two good questions, so I decided to come to speak to you, and here we're saluting you from the heart of the Carbon region in eastern Pennsylvania, the home of the Molly Maguires, and I had some interesting questions from you, some health-related questions, because some of you are, one of you kind of like has cancer and stuff like that, and the medical aspect, the medical field is kind of my, one of my strong points, having been a physician in Santo Domingo, and I worked at the cancer center there, and the Carl George Hospital, the Hospital of El Seguro Social, which is a hospital for Haitians, and of course at the large central hospital of the university, which is in the capital. I worked in all these places, and I have a little experience, and the information I'm going to give to you, which is some medical information, is information that's given to you as a public. This is public information. I'm not giving you this information for any treatment, or I'm not giving you the treatment for any disease you might have. This is public information. I'm giving it out as that. I have to say that so I don't get in trouble, accused of giving out medical information. But you do have a constitutional right to apply any treatment to yourself. You can treat yourself. And so you have to, I suggest that any treatment that you do use, that you see your doctor or a naturopathic doctor, if you believe in using things like plants and vitamins and stuff like that, because naturopathic doctors are more open to using that sort of thing. Traditional doctors, we kind of look down on the use of herbs and other naturopathic remedies stuff. We have an incredible body. It's an unbelievable mechanism created by Hashem himself, and it's incredible how your body instantly responds to almost any sickness that you could have. For example, if you happen to cut your hand and there's a bacteria that comes in there, your body almost instantly knows that that bacteria has entered your body and starts preparing antibodies to destroy that bacteria or infective agent. And we know this because in the last 20 years, our science of immunology has advanced so much that we can marvel at how the human body reacts to infection, even cancer. You know, your body knows how to fight cancer. And one of the problems when you're sick of any illness is the human body requires, when it's producing antibodies and fighting an infection, it requires incredible amounts. It requires much more protein than regular. Okay, and it's hard to believe in this country, in America, where there's so much food that a good 30 to 40% of Americans are undernourished. And that's because they eat quantities of food, but they don't eat. We take our bodies for granted. We're more worried about, does it taste good, than is it good? And the fact is, a lot of food industries put health on a very low priority in our society. So you can't just go by what tastes good in your mouth. You really have to nowadays, you have to pay a close attention to what you're eating. Because what some of these people put in these canned foods, for example, is poisonous stuff. A lot of poisonous things are being put in the food. Because a lot of these food industries are motivated by the good old dollar, right? The bottom line. And so you have to be really aware of what you eat, and what you drink. If you get a sickness such as cancer or some debilitating chronic disease, one of the first things that hits you is the stigma that the medical industry puts on the disease. For example, if you have cancer, oh my goodness, you know, most cancer patients begin their treatment in a depressed state. They're depressed because the stigma of cancer is so great that a lot of patients immediately get depressed. And we know through clinical studies and through the science of immunology that a depressed patient, when you're depressed, your immune system gets depressed also right away. All right? And we know this. We know. Clinical studies have proven this, that a patient that is relaxed and positive and accompanied by a person or an animal is much 20 to 30% more able to fight an infection, for example, than a patient that's depressed. Okay? And when you hit the stigma hits you that you have cancer, it's sort of like you're already tying your left hand behind your back to fight that disease. Okay? Another thing is that you have to understand, when you get an infection, Many of the treatments given to you depress the immune system. For example, antibiotics depress the immune system. So let's say you have an infection and you're taking an antibiotic for that infection. That antibiotic will work in that infection, against that infection, but your defenses against other infections will go down. Your immune system gets depressed. Many antibiotics do this. And chemotherapy wreaks havoc on the human body as far as its immune system is concerned. So, I mean, what am I telling you? What I'm telling you is you have to be aware of these things. And if the doctor gives you a year to live, you could take 1 month out of that year and devote it to trying to heal yourself using natural remedies, naturopathic remedies. I remember I had a woman, I used to know a woman, her name was Maria. And she used to live on Bower Street in Jersey City. Jersey City Heights. And I had a family member of her come over to me and talk to me about her. And she asked me, she said, "Doctor, can you come to my house and speak to my sister? She's got cancer." And I told her I can't provide her any treatment for cancer. I can only counsel her. And she said, "Fine, you know, you can counsel her." Her name was Maria, and I came over to her house. And they were all depressed and weeping, of course, because the doctors had found cancer in her. And they sent her home basically to die. They told her that she had liver cancer. And the doctors told her that she had 2 weeks to live. And I said, "Do you mind if I, check your body, check your heart?" She says, "Go right ahead." I took my stethoscope, I checked the body, I gave her a physical. And sure enough, in her right flank, in her liver, she had a tumor about the size of a baseball. This is a small woman. The woman was about 100 pounds. And the tumor occupied a good portion of the central of the liver. And it could easily be palpated, right? And I ministered to her. I told her that only God can tell her when she was going to die. And I raised her spirits up. And I didn't give her treatment, but I suggested certain... that she go to the health food store and pick up certain herbs that are good for her condition. And we'll make a long story short. The tumor disappeared about a month later. And then the tumor went to her lungs, and we fought that. Her lungs cleared up. And I used a system of sounds, vibration and sounds, to make the tumor disappear, and it worked on her lungs. And she was there 3 months later, 4 months later, 5 months later, 6 months later. And she told me, I was supposed to die in 2 weeks. Well, what? And I told her, only God can decide when you die. Only God can decide when you die. No doctor can tell you when you can die. And 7 months later, 8 months later, it became necessary for me to travel to Santo Domingo, trying to get my medical degree over there from my medical school. And while I was in Santo Domingo, her family despaired and took her to the doctor. And of course, the doctor immediately put her in the hospital, and she died 2 weeks later after in her care. And the reason I'm telling you that story is... you have to use wisdom. If the doctor gives you 6 months to live, 8 months to live, before they start pumping you with all those poisons, you might try praying for a month. You might try giving God a chance for a month or for a little while to see if he'll heal you. Right? Before you start getting pumped with all these poisons that will immediately depress your immune system and your ability to fight whatever you have, whether it's cancer or something else. And that's a very long topic, how you fight cancer and stuff, so we can't really go into it, but just a little bit. Now, your body, your body can destroy almost anything that tries to destroy it. If you give your human body needs fresh water, clear fresh water, right? Without chlorine and without fluorides. Chlorine and fluorides are very highly poisonous compounds. That's why we have so much cancer. We have a lot of cancer in this society. Because all our food is filled with cancer-producing compounds. The water is the first thing that's poisoned with chlorine and fluoride. Especially fluoride. It's unbelievably toxic. So, you know, if you do drink water from the your house water, directly from the pipe, you can filter your water, right? You can buy a Brita water filter. It costs about $25 or so. And you can use, you know, filter your water, and you can drink chlorine-free water. The filters work. Now, if your city is putting fluoride, that's a much more poisonous compound. Then you have to do. There are filters specifically made to filter fluoride. But don't put anything in your body that causes cancer, you know. Right? And so, you know, if you're drinking fresh water and you have a certain amount of, you have a balance in your physical activity. We don't think of the body as a machine, but that's exactly, it's a very sophisticated machine. And you have to give it water and you have to give it the right nutrients and with the right exercise and the right spirituality, you can defeat almost any disease that comes upon you. Cancer included. In this society, you have to assume that you have cancer in your body to begin with. That's why it's important to fast at least once a month. And that fasting can help to destroy any cancer cells that are in your body thinking of growing. So so I told you about the story of Maria. And, you know, pay attention to what you eat. People, you know, when the Jews left Egypt, one of the things that Hashem addressed with them was their diet. And he told them, these are, you know, don't eat this, don't eat that. He had, you know, today, a lot of you are not eating pork. Why? Because your cardiologist tells you not to do it. Why didn't you obey God when he told you? When God told you to avoid pork, why didn't you avoid it then? Why do you need your cardiologist to tell you this? Don't you trust God's wisdom? God's wisdom, right? Don't eat pork, you know. Don't eat these prohibited animals. Because God gave this prohibition with great wisdom. Right? I mean, a human being has about 7,000 white blood cells per cubic inch of per drop of blood. In a drop of blood in a human being, you have about 7,000 white blood cells. White blood cells is another word for pus. It's that component in your bloodstream that fights infection. You have about 7,000 white blood cells. A pig has about 22,000 white blood cells per drop. His blood is partly pus. It's a completely unhealthy animal. I mean, the animal is blessed because he does a very important job. He goes around and he eats garbage and all the poisons that will kill us. That's his job. And God gives him a special protection so he could tolerate those poisons. And his body is made full of pus to fight the poisons that he eats. But, you know, that animal, it's not fit to be consumed by humans. As a matter of fact, meat has been, more and more, a lot of our meat has been poisoned. Genetically altered foods, most of you are eating genetically altered foods. And that's why I'm walking in the street, when I see a human being, I say, look, he eats mostly chicken, he eats mostly beef, he eats mostly pork. I could tell by the shapes of your bodies, because the hormones and the hormones and genetic engineering done on those animals, when you eat that animal, you take that on. You take on the hormones, and you take on the genetic engineering of those animals. That's why some of you look like chickens, some of you look like pigs, and some of you look like turkeys. Your body, that's why you can't go down in weight. Your body is made to go down in weight very easily. But, you know, you're constantly eating these foods that are filled with hormones that are meant to slow down your metabolism and to make you gain weight. That's why they give it to the animals, so they gain weight and they look nice and delicious for you. So we have to take care of our bodies and be aware of this. I mean, when you eat a tuna sandwich or a nice salad, when you eat a nice piece of fish, it's digested in 2 hours. It leaves the stomach almost in 2 hours. And your body easily absorbs this. But when you eat heavier flesh, like for example beef or pork, some of that food stays 4 to 6 hours in the stomach. Your body has a very difficult time digesting that. By the time it leaves the body, it's got worms already in it. And that's why some of you are so sick. I was listening the other day on CNN. This pastor that got up to preach in a church, and when he was at the top of his sermon, he got a heart attack right there, died on the pulpit. That made me very sick to my stomach, because those are deaths that are not necessary. Okay? I mean, most heart attacks occur between 7 and 9 o'clock in the morning. And if you're going to get a heart attack, most of the time it's going to be in the morning, and I'm going to tell you why. When you go to sleep, your body shuts down a lot of its physiological activities. For example, during the night, you're not drinking water, but you're losing a lot of water. Right, you're losing water. Your urine, you produce a certain amount of urine, and when you exhale, that breath that you're exhaling is 100% saturated with water. It's a water vapor. Your body is you're producing water vapor. Regular, when you breathe in, that air is about 30% humidity, but when you breathe out, the humidity of that air you're breathing is about 100%. You lose quite a bit of fluids while you're sleeping. And that has a tendency to increase the viscosity of the blood. When you wake up in the morning, your blood is a lot thicker, right? Because of that, it concentrates the blood. And if you eat a late meal, if you eat after 7 o'clock, all those food particles are in your blood, increase the osmolarity of your blood. All those food particles are in your intestine. When you get up and you do sudden activities like what you do in the morning, you get up, you get dressed, and the kids off to school, that viscosity in your blood is very high, and a lot of that food that's in your intestines gets thrown into the bloodstream, and all that thick blood filled with nutrients, it goes to those tiny capillaries in the heart, and there you go, in the middle of the sermon, you're getting a heart attack. So the best thing to do is at night, try to eat early. Try to make it so that you know that the food is out of your system by the time you go to sleep. So if you eat around 5 or 6, that's good. If you have to eat at 7 or 8, make it a very light meal. Right? Make it a very light meal. And if you have to eat late, because I know that sometimes we have to eat late, one of the things you can do is before you go to sleep, you just take half of a baby aspirin. All right, it has to have salicylic acid, not Tylenol. Just half of a baby aspirin to keep those platelets and to keep that blood thinned down a little bit. That little bit of salicylic acid. I mean, they have that in leaf form. You could buy a leaf with salicylic acid, and just take that before you go to sleep. So then when you wake up in the morning, your blood is not thick and ready to give you a heart attack. But we have to be strategic with this, right? In the old days, the heavy meals were in the morning and the afternoon. The light meals today, because we work most of the day. Most of us eat heavy meals late at night. And that's why this is lot of heart attacks. And the inside of the arteries are very muscular. The veins are not muscular, but the arteries are. I mean, while you're doing surgery, if you see a blood vessel, one of the ways you know it's a vein or artery is you just touch it with your finger. If it's muscular, that's an artery. And it's, if it's not muscular, that's a vein. That's one of the ways that you can tell. But the arteries are muscular, and in the inside, it has a very thin membrane. I forget what it's called in English. In the medical Spanish language, it's called la íntima, which means the intimate. And that's a very elastic membrane, right? And the over time, that elasticity of that membrane has a tendency to go down. It, instead of being elastic, it gets thick and brittle, and that's what leads to arteriosclerosis and a lot of problems. And the way you keep that intima elastic is every day you do a certain amount of acceleration. It could be a 20-minute walk. It could be exercising in your office. It could be lifting weights in your office. And just to stimulate that cardiovascular system, to stretch that those arteries out during the day and help keep that system in shape. So you minimize the amount of heart attacks that you get. All right. Hi, there's several of you that have decided to convert yourselves to Judaism, and the Shekinah has gone out. She's dressed up, and she's looking for lovers, right? The Shekinah has gone out, and she will not say no to you if you try to convert yourself, especially if you don't have a community, a Jewish community next to you. For example, I'm in the mountains here. There's no Jews here where I am. So if you're in that same situation, you can do that. The work of the Jewish people were to deliver to you the temple, the Messiah, and the Torah. And you have the Torah with you, and you can use the Torah to... the way you should go about that is just sit down and ask yourself, what does a Jew do in a day? Figure out what a Jew does in a day, an Israelite. Then ask yourself, what does a Jew do in a week? Then ask yourself, and you write this down, just make a research out of it. Right? What a Jew does in a day. You're going to research it, write about it. It'll take you a week to study that. And you'll know that the religion of Hashem consists of praising Hashem, blessing Him 100 times a day. So you'll want to download the blessings, and you'll want to become acquainted with that, times of the blessings. And after you know what a Jew does in a day, then you find out what he does in a week. For example, the week is punctuated by Friday night, right? And by Havdalah. And you learn that. You learn Kiddush, and you learn Havdalah. And then that'll take you a few weeks. And after that, you ask yourself, what does an Israelite do in a month? And you learn about the Kodesh, the moon services. And that's when you start learning about the holidays. And this is how you start converting yourself. And you can post that in the library, for example. You can say, I'm converting myself to Judaism. Does anybody want to join in? And you'll be surprised. People will be intrigued and want to learn the Torah and want to convert with you. I can almost guarantee you that. All right? And when you're ready, then you can travel to a city where there's a Jewish community and plan to live there 6 months. And they'll help you through the conversion process. All right? So feel good. Feel positive. There's no reason, if you're not surrounded by a Jewish community and you don't have any rabbis next to you, the Shekinah will not say no to you. The Shekinah will welcome you. All right. Yeah, the last time I talked about two events which were miraculous in my life. Number one, when the blood appeared on the wall, And the other event, somebody asked me, like, you know, were there any witnesses? And I think I told you last time, when the that first event, when the wall appeared covered with blood in my mother's house, my mother and father, they were there, they saw it, they helped me clean the blood, and they're witnesses, they're very easy to talk to, and those two people are witnesses to what happened. And the other story that I told you, these stories are in my notes, by the way. And in that second story, that was, I think it was a Sunday, and I was in the kitchen, and I was frying eggs for my brother-in-law. He was sitting right there. And I was talking to him about God and talking to him about the end days, and that I believe that there would be end days. And halfway through my sermon, the house shook, and it was wind. And whatever it was, the window was to my left, it landed in the yard like a bomb, like a light bomb. And whatever it was, before I could move away, it came through the window and hit me right in the left eye. Remember the old days when you used to get punched and suddenly you saw the light and stuff? Well, that's what it was. I got hit in my left eye. And it threw me up in the air. I'm surprised it didn't fall on the eggs that I was cooking. But it threw me up in the air and I fell on one knee. And pretty much woke. I got up like a drunk man. I thought I was hit by lightning. But I asked my brother-in-law. He says, I didn't see no lightning. I saw fire from the stove. It wrapped itself around you. And if you want to... And I smelled myself to see if I was struck by fire, and I didn't smell like fire or nothing. And I get tormented when I see spiritual things like that, because I'm a very scientific and a very hard-to-believe type of an individual. But that was my Shemitah. That was my presence that came down. And... like a splinter under my left eye. And sometimes I can feel a presence looking out of me, almost like, you know, but this is what we want, right? We don't want a flying saucer coming with God, Holy Spirit. We're not waiting for some crying virgin over in Mexico. God said that He would be with us through our brethren, right? Through our brothers and sisters. And so I'm here with you. And the Shekinah is also here with you. And sometimes I feel that you're kind of looking at it. It's a very scary thing. But that's your alien power. That's the alien power of Israel. Alright? And we can talk a little bit more about this and stuff. But it has an effect on my throat. I mean, changes voices and stuff. But that event, my brother-in-law, you can speak to him about that. He saw the event. His name is Candido Polanco. I try to avoid using names, but since the events are so incredible, you can talk to him. And he is in San Pedro de Macorís, Dominican Republic, and he is a Mason, a high degree Mason. And he can talk to you. I've been wanting to reach out to him and see if he could write down the event, but I'm saying on Facebook, so I feel like I know that some of you Masons are going to reach out to him. Oh yeah, I had received some questions about Masons and stuff like that. Because I think I mentioned to you that some of my family actually helped organize the Illuminati and stuff like that. And some of you asked me, am I Mason? And some of you asked me about Masonry. Listen, Masons are just like you and me, they're regular people. You know, many of them are looking for truth. Some of them are Christians, some of them are Jews. Some of them are rotten people, and some of them are satanic people. And it's a mixed group of people, and I have nothing against them. I mean, their leadership is something else, though, right? That's an entirely different thing. But the regular Masons are people just like you and me. I mean, I'm not a Mason. I've spoken to Masons. I've done miracles in front of Masons, and I discovered their mouth drop just like regular people. They just want to learn, you know. They don't have superpowers and stuff like that. But and I've been invited to preach at Masonic halls and stuff like that, and I've been visited by like the highest level Masons and stuff, because I have a lot of things to talk about that they're interested in. A lot of them are spiritual people and they're interested in. And I talk to them just like I would talk to any Jewish mystics, people interested in these. Listen, you know, you have to draw close to the Torah, because the Torah is not just a book. Torah is an oracle. And as you study each miracle, as you study each event in the Torah, what happens is these events start occurring to you, start happening to you. And you will start having those miracles that are in the Torah. Right? Don't approach the Torah like an intellectual pursuit. You're going to get cursed, first of all. Because when you open the Torah, the Shekinah crowds around you to see if you're going to be approaching it in the right way. Alright? What the Shekinah wants to do is, it wants to take over your with the information. It wants you to be taken over by the information. Because Hashem and the Shekinah, they're expulsed from the earth. It's illegal for them to be on the earth. But they can be in you. And this is where we can bring Hashem into the earth. Right? You're Hashem's invasion force. And when you invite Hashem in, you come in contact with that Shekinah that's within you. And that Shekinah now comes into the world. And that's why you are the greatest enemies that Satan has. Right? That's why there's a death warrant out on each and every one of you. The moment that you start allowing the Shekinah to bring into you holiness and allow the Shekinah to work through you in the world, you are going to get tremendous blessings, because when you cross into the spiritual, you're going to see there's no such thing as death. There's no such thing as death. And I have to qualify that. But what I want you to do is I want you to cross into the spiritual world, so you're going to laugh at death. You're going to realize that there's nothing to be worrying about. Death is a fantasy created by Satan himself. Death, the fear of death. I have to talk to you about death, but for us there's Hashem's kingdom, right? There's no reason to fear death, and this is something that you could teach your children. And this is why I want you to get it. This is the greatest thing that I want, so that you can realize that how great Hashem has for us, the plan for us. But so I took care of that. You can speak to Candido, say hello for him for me, and he'll tell you about what he saw and stuff. And that's very important to me, that I identify those people, because they were witnesses to those events. And that's what I wrote down to speak to you today. And I got a question from Jewish people and Christian people and stuff like that. Like, somebody asked me, am I interested in converting Muslims to Judaism? I get questions like, are you interested in converting Muslims to Judaism, to Christianity? Are you interested in converting Jews to Christianity? Are you interested? I mean, I want nothing, really. I don't even want to convert people to Jews. I mean, yes, I want you to get to know the Shekinah. That's what I want you to get you to know. And I'm qualifying that, because a lot of temples do not have rabbis that are filled with the Shekinah. And I don't want to invite you. Yes, you have to get to a Jewish temple, but I want your connection to be with the Shekinah herself. Right? And that's what I have for you. Right? I want to spit you in the eye, because I have the milk of the Shekinah in my mouth. And when I spit you in the eye, you're going to blink and you're never going to see things the same. And all I have for you is the breast of the Shekinah. That's all that I have for you. The warm milk of the breast of the Shekinah to transform you and to turn you into something that you're not. A super being, something else. Right? Other than just an intellectual Jew, an intellectual Christian. You have to come into the spiritual world and start enjoying the sunlight of Hashem's throne. And somebody told me about a poem that I wrote. Did you really see Hashem? Yes, I did. I saw Hashem when I was 15 years old. And part of me is still 15 years old. Okay? And Hashem, when I saw Hashem, the Shekinah that was there, The Shekinah that covers, the light that covers them is about 300 to 400 feet across. It's a white light that allows you to see. You can just about see into the Hashem himself. And he has, he's sitting on something that looks like a huge chair, like a throne. And you could just see the outlines of his form and his face and his body. And I praise Hashem that he allowed me to see him that way. And behind that light, there's a hurricane of lightning and thunder and voices. And he is just indescribable. Hashem is a consuming fire. Hashem is a consuming power. He's a nuclear weapon bottled in a bottle. He's an unbelievable phenomenon. God is an unbelievable phenomenon. This is Hashem, the God of Israel. And I invite all my Christian friends to get to know Hashem. Your Lord and Savior took a lot of time out to introduce you. And there's a certain verse where he says, "Father, the world has not known you, but I have spoken to them about." He wept because the world did not know Hashem. The world did not know the Father. And this is his greatest desire, that you know his power, because that when you know Hashem, when you know his power, you can produce his acts, his miracles, his holiness. That's the only way to do it. All right? You can follow him all your life and you never do any of the things he did. But when you get to his power, when you discover that his greatest desire was to introduce you to Hashem, then you're going to discover that all of you are going to do all the stuff that he did, all the miracles that he did. Okay? So I want you to get to know the God of Israel. And that's what your Lord and Savior, that was what he did. He spoke of his Father all the time. Paul was the one that preached, you know, Christ crucified and stuff like that. Which Paul lived at a time of martyrdom, a difficult time for the. But long before that, when the man of Nazareth, Israel, was occupied, and his primary concern was a movement of holiness, how to bring holiness to the Jewish people. That was his movement. So Paul had his movement. And Yeshua had his movement of holiness. And I'm not saying to you that they're completely apart, even though Paul never met the man from Nazareth. And even, you know, I don't want you to think that they're enemies, but I want you to start realizing that they were two separate men, and each one had a different mission, right? Paul had a mission, and the man from Nazareth had a mission. And what I want you to understand is, I want to bring you back to the religion of the man from Nazareth. That's my purpose. And I can do that through the temple. But I want you to experience revival, because revival occurs at the same time with reform. Reform and revival come together. If you're unwilling to reform, don't wait for revival, and vice versa. All right? If you want to reform and you're not expecting revival, it's not going to work. Reform comes with revival. When you say, you know, God, show, you know, people wait around. When the Spirit of God comes, he's not coming to hear what you have to say. You have to be willing and waiting to do what he wants you to do. All right? And the first thing he's going to ask you to do is to eliminate this denominationalism between the Christian churches. And that doesn't mean going out and joining the Pope and joining the ecumenical. No, it means drawing closer to each other. Drawing closer as churches and drawing closer as congregations and crossing hands across denominations, and by all means calling for repentance, because this is exactly how, you know, you are going to be identified. You know, when the angels come for you, they're not going to come asking your names. They're going to look at you and they're going to see holiness, and that comes only through Shuvah. Comes only to repentance and through the desire to reform yourself and to overcome and to live a holy life on the earth. So Haverim, what a pleasure it is to have reached out to you like this, and let's see if we can make our interventions more popular, more numerous, and Let me just leave you with a few more words here. And Hashem is returning to his people, returning to Israel. And he's going to destroy his enemies and anyone that comes against Israel and anyone that goes against the holiness of Israel. So, Leila Tov, and I'll see you on the internet.